Good afternoon, everyone. It's welcome to the afternoon session on this Thursday of LCA 2017. It's my distinct pleasure now to introduce Joel Stanley, who is a firmware developer and kernel hacker at IBM OzLabs, based in Adelaide, and he'll be speaking about sys/class/gpio/parking brake. So take it away, Joel.
Thanks very much, Michael. Thanks everyone for having me, and welcome to my talk. I hope you had a good LCA so far. So I've been around LCA for a little while now. I've been coming for 10 years straight and a few more before that. And I've given a bunch of presentations at free and open source software conferences, including this one. I've spoken about the Summer of Code project, where I ported Chrome to ARM and used a beagle board to measure the power consumption of Chrome compared to Firefox. A friend and I, who's in the crowd, wrote some homebrew for the Wii that would have allowed us to watch ABC iView if we'd ever got around to finishing it. One year I demoed some hardware and software that turned an Android phone into a software-defined HF rodeo for receiving a low bitrate voice codec. And then there was the time that my friends and I launched a high-altitude balloon, and we chased it from Geelong down to Melbourne. So as you can see, I've got a bunch of hobbies that revolve around doing interesting things with computers of varying sizes. For my day job, I've helped build a few different embedded Linux systems for a few companies. One of them was a metal detector used for finding treasure in the soil. That one had an IMX25 ARM processor running Linux to provide the user interface. And more recently, I've been working on OpenBMC, which is a project to create a free and open source software management firmware, initially for open power servers. And I'm the kernel maintainer for the ARM A-speed system on chip that we use in that one there. So along the way, I've learned a lot about the tools of the trade we use for building embedded systems, Yocto, Buildroot, as well as the challenges involved in building embedded systems, making them easy to develop on, hitting shipping deadlines for the product, and making them updatable in the field. These are all challenges I've had to overcome, and I kept those lessons in mind when I was tearing apart someone else's work. Onto my car. So I got a new car in 2016. This is the first car I'd ever owned. I managed to make it to 31 before having to own a large hunk of dinosaur-powered metal. But I was super excited, because this car came with a nice-looking touchscreen computer in the dash. This interface was for playing music, observing statistics about how the engine was performing, and viewing the live video stream from the reversing camera on the back of my car. And although I didn't purchase the navigation package that could have come with it, the dealer told me that the car contained a Wi-Fi. And the Wi-Fi device was designed to allow the car to receive live traffic updates while I was parked in my garage. And then when I go out driving, it'll know where the accidents are and take me safely and efficiently to work in the morning, or at least in theory. So at the first opportunity, I sat in the driver's seat with the car parked in the garage and associated the car with my home Wi-Fi network. Unlike any self-respecting security researcher, I didn't put it on an isolated network or log the traffic, but probably should have done that for next time. So let me stop here, though. One thing that's important when developing any system, and that goes equally for exploring one that needs to keep operating, is not to break it. In the industry, we called that turning it into a brick. And I didn't want my purchase to turn into a $30,000 brick. And even more than that, the co-owner of the car, my partner, didn't want me to do that, and she reminded me regularly. So the Wi-Fi. I had to enter my 18-character WPA key with the jog dial in the center console. By the way, that's my actual Wi-Fi SSID. If you're ever visiting Adelaide, the passwords can't stop the signal. You're welcome to use it. So now I had my Wi-Fi associated. With the car on the network, I needed to discover its IP. A quick nmap scan revealed the victim IP address, and a bit more probing showed that the device was running Linux. Success. So not only was running Linux, but there was an open port, port 22, SSH. I tried to connect, but I had to downgrade the ciphers and the key exchange algorithms that my SSH client was using. But after doing that, I eventually got the request to authenticate. So I tried all the passwords I knew, root, password, QWERTY, God, Hunter 2, none of them worked, no luck. So I did what any self-respecting engineer of the current age does when they're stuck. I typed into a search engine. The first hit took me to a wiki page that contained the, count it, 1, 2, 3 character password that every single Mazda head unit uses. So I was in. uh, Let's think about this for a minute. When developers are building a product, they're going to enable certain features to make their life easier. This might mean enabling NFS booting in the kernel, or turning on USB to Ethernet drivers so that they can get Ethernet access to a device that might not otherwise have a port, or adding SSH to the build. On top of that, they'll want a simple short password that they can easily type in. They're going to be logging this system tens and tens of times a day, and they're not going to be wanting to type in a 16-character random password every time. So I don't blame them for having such a short password. But perhaps next time, as part of their manufacturing provisioning process, they could have set something a little bit more complex. So what do we have here so far? We've got an embedded Linux system. It's attached to the CAN bus of the car, as well as the speakers, the GPS antenna, some buttons in the center console. It's a touch screen. And it's also got Bluetooth and Wi-Fi connectivity, in addition to a pair of USB ports on the front. So now that I was in, it was time to do some exploring. The head unit's running Linux kernel 3.0.35. 3.0 was released in 2011. This was a brand new car. It had been manufactured a couple months before it rolled up in my driveway. So 3.0.35 is a little bit newer than the 3.0 release. It's a stable point release. And in the Linux kernel development process, we have the concept of stable kernel releases, where essential fixes are backported according to a bunch of stable tree kernel rules. So it means at some point in some life of this machine, someone did care about security fixes, which was good to know. In my day job, I regularly update the kernel we use for our firmware to use the latest version of the stable tree. So sometimes this takes a bit of work, and sometimes it happens multiple times in 1 week when Greg's really busy. But the reason this is really easy and painless, often it's really easy and painless, which means my users, our users, get the latest bug fixes that the kernel might have. So an important aspect of that is the fact that the product I work on has an upstream kernel support. So without that, I'd have to resolve all the conflicts when I rebase on the stable tree, increasing my workload. And then when I do decide to move to a new kernel base, I'm going to have to spend time forward porting all that out of tree code that I've got to a new base, again wasting my time. Time that would be better spent here at conferences. So because the code is all upstream, the responsibility of doing that porting work is on the wider Linux kernel community. And as they change internal APIs, they're going to keep my code up to date for me. So this upstreaming process is a vital piece in the puzzle in keeping the embedded systems up to date and secure. So the system on chip used in my car is a Freescale IMX Q6, now NXP, because NXP bought Freescale. So it's a quad-core ARM Cortex A9. You understand what that means if you're at Thomas's talk yesterday. It's got a gig of RAM, half a gig of flash, and a whole host of peripherals on it. And this bit of hardware happened to be supported upstream in just one kernel after the one that's running in Linux 3.2 back in 2011 due to some work by Lenaro. And the board that they added support for was called Sabre. If you look at the marketing material for that online, that was an automotive development board. So there's a fair chance that that board was used for prototyping the machine in my car. So the user space is running a version of Opera's web browser on top of Wayland. And because it's running a web browser, it's just the UI is a combination of JavaScript and HTML. Now, there are a few notable apps inside there. One of the more interesting ones for me was this GStreamer application. And that was taking video from the dev video device, a standard Linux character device. There was the video feed from the rear of the car. So it was overlaying this nice reversing pattern on the stream of video coming from my tailgate and putting it on the screen for me to see what was happening when I was reversing. There was a bit more going on there. There's a bunch of Lua apps for controlling the audio. They were talking D-bus to each other. There were a few more apps for playing back MP3s and audio from the CD. There was a DV application, which was kind of interesting because nothing in the UI suggests that users can play DVDs. Some research suggested the UI was something called the OpenCar SDK. And you can copy off the HTML and JavaScript onto your PC and fire up a local web server and view it in your browser, which sounds like it'd be nice and easy to develop for on a PC. This OpenCar company, they happened to be acquired by another company called Inrix last year, and they're a proprietary software company doing software for car computers. But let's hold up here a bit. How did this system come to be? How did we get to this point? And what's involved in building and shipping an embedded Linux system? So as I mentioned before, an embedded analytics system consists of a whole heap of components. Often you're going to have a bootloader, a kernel, and some user space on top. And all of this is built by some kind of cross-compilation toolkit, allowing the code developed and built on your x86 laptop and then deployed to the embedded hardware. Some of the tools for doing that are Yocto and Open Embedded and Buildroot. And they're kind of like a desktop Linux distribution in that they have a selection of packages that you can choose to build into your embedded system, as well as the cross-compiler and C library and supporting infrastructure you need for doing that. So these system building tools, they make regular releases where they update the packages to the latest upstream versions. And so in the case of Buildroot, which I've found to be the easiest to use tool for doing this work, they make releases every 3 months. And so you're going to do a security update in some package. It's going to get updated into Buildroot. And then Buildroot are going to do a release. So your packages are going to be a month or two old by the time Buildroot does a release. And on top of that, the development team are going to do they're going to add their user space on top. They're going to do some kind of integration testing and then create a build and ship it out to customers. So there's going to be a finite amount of time between when the security patch bugs are fixed and you get them in your hands in the best case. And that's probably going to be a bit longer than for your desktop Linux distribution like you used to. But looking inside the car, that wasn't the case at all. As an example, there was a version of OpenSSL inside there. Now, they were shipping OpenSSL 098K, which is from a while ago. It happens to be post-Heartbleed by 1 month, so they dodged that bullet. But it's still horribly out of date. There's been 14 security fixes to that branch of OpenSSL since it was released. And while none of them might affect this device, given it's not serving web pages to the public internet, it's not the best situation. And this is pretty indicative of embedded hardware and the issues in systems that we're going to be running. So now we've got our bit of hardware there. It's all packaged up into a sequence of binaries, usually one after the other, spaced out with a partitioning scheme, so you can update one without updating the other. And then copied to internal memory, some kind of NAND or NOR or something inside the embedded device. But that's just a bit of background about how the sausage is made. So we'll keep looking at what's inside the head unit. The head unit, the Mazda marketing material calls it MZD Connect. That's what the marketing team named it. But the software inside is produced by a company with the acronym JCI. And doing some googly around, that looks like it's a company called Jason Controls. I did a bunch of searching on their website and in the documentation of my car and the manual it came with, and there wasn't a written offer for the GPL. There was a link buried in the UI, which you can see up here, for Mazda End User Agreements-copyrights.com, and that's serving up a PDF file that has a bunch of copyright notices for Lua, LZMA, libjpeg, freetype, zlib, others, but not the kernel and not BusyBox, which is inside this box. So that's something to pursue at a future date. So back to hacking the car. To my excitement, I found some other apps inside the root file system. There was this terminal app, and I could launch it through SSH. So up it popped. Problem is, I didn't have a keyboard plugged in, and the various buttons that are on the car would get me a Z and an A and a backspace, but not a full keyboard. But I'd had a bit of play with that, and I control-C'd it, and it stayed there. Panic. What do I do now? Oh, I turn it off and on again, of course. So I press the ignition. It's a keyless ignition car. And let the car go off and come back on, and it was still there. So a bit more stressing, but as it turned out, the car had a control-alt-delete equivalent, so I pressed the magic combination and the head unit rebooted and came back, and I took a sigh of relief, but it was a little bit more cautious from there on in. So it was at this point that I excitedly told my workmates in our group chat that we had and decided that this should become a LinuxConf.au talk. They supported some gentle encouragement, including one of my managers there, Abby, who hashtag hacked that car. Thanks, Abby. I'm sure it's going to get me the raise in case I bricked it. A few months later, I submitted the LCA talk. It was accepted. I was very grateful for that. And I decided to continue my exploration of the car in order to get more information and prepare this talk. So I jumped in the car, reassured my partner yet again that I wasn't going to brick the car, and fired up SSH. Nothing. I blamed my flaky home Wi-Fi connection, did a quick grep of the logs on the access point, and that, it was all good. It was getting an IP, but I just wasn't getting anything back. No ports were responding anymore. So in the intervening time, between the first hacking experience and this point, the car had passed its 1,000K mark, which meant it went back to the dealer for its first service. And at that time, they helpfully updated the firmware for me. There were some changes in there that were blocking me out of SSH, and my talk plans were ruined. And just as a quick aside, this does make you wonder what rights as a consumer you should have when you take your product along to get serviced. You know, should I expect them to have done this? Should they have asked me? Should I have even had to have waited till I've gone to service? You know, it was a mechanical service, not a software update that I was checking in for. So it's something for us to consider in, you know, the people involved in every stage of the kind of supply chain of creating products. But back to the hardware. So not only did it contain a Wi-Fi device, but there were two USB ports on the dash of the car. And they were designed for putting media on, so you could put your MP3s on there and play them back and whatever. On a mass storage device. But a bit more research revealed that if I plugged the USB Ethernet dongle in there, it would load the kernel driver for it and ask for an IP over DHCP. So that was useful. Thank you, developers from JCI. So I happened to have a whole stash of these. Back in a previous life, I did a bunch of hacking on the one laptop by Child XO, which, similar to this machine, lacked any Ethernet. So I went to my stash of USB Ethernet adapters and tried them out. But fortunately, my wonderfully modern Lenovo X1 lacks any Ethernet ports. So even though I could get something from the car, I couldn't plug into my laptop. And I was getting frustrated running back and forth out of the garage and whatnot. So I decided to pursue something else. So a bit more research. Turns out there's some documentation out there, a PDF for the service process that Mazda cars have, which suggested there was some diagnostic tool you'd run on Windows, and it would load up a USB mass storage device, a USB key, with a bunch of configuration that, when plugged into the head unit, would scrape out some diagnostics and allow the technician to see what was wrong with the car. So it turned out there were two magic files on there. One was called JCI Auto Update. That just contained a new line. That's what the A is there. And there was one called Data Retrieval Config.txt. And that had a nice parameter in it that let you run arbitrary commands as root. So whenever you plug this key in, it would run cmd underline as root and let you do whatever you felt like. So I used this as a poor man's shell. I'd load it up with some scripts, seeing what processes are running, seeing what the state of the file system was, seeing the SSHD configuration, state of IP tables. And the way I did that was I had a script that would dump the output of the shell back to the USB key. So I'd load it up and plug it into the car. And it helpfully popped up to say service complete after it had finished, and unplug it again. Back to the laptop, examine the output. Oh, forgot the semicolon, you know, etc. But luckily, the best thing about this little process, it was stateless. If I stuffed something up, I could reboot the head unit, and I hadn't stuffed anything up. So it gave me confidence I wouldn't brick the car. So I found a few interesting things while I was there. SSH had now been set to key-based authentication. No more passwords. SSH was now listening on port 3600, which was kind of unusual, but whatever. And IP Devils was denying most incoming connections except for DNS and DHCP. So that's why I couldn't get any packets out of the device. And so access had been deliberately disabled by the dealer through an update from the manufacturer. And again, my plans for the talk were in ruins. While I was looking for a slide about IP tables, I came across this image a couple of years ago. A friend, Ryan, who's here doing AV at the conference, had a project where he was raising money for charity, and in return, they had to drive a $1,000 car across the Australian outback. And one of the sponsors was LCA's own Rusty Russell, who threw in a bunch of cash, and the sticker that they put on the back of the car for his support was the IP tables masquerading rules. That was my slide about IP tables. So IP tables, using my elite IP table skills and my trusty USB shell, USB key shell, I flashed all the IP tables rules and could get back in. But the problem was still I couldn't authenticate. You know, I can't break RSA, so I didn't have the private key to talk to this device. But what I could do is run my own drop-back client on the machine. You might wonder why I didn't play with the SSH configuration. And it goes back to how the embedded software is created. Often these systems will separate their flash into something for the bootloader, the kernel, the root file system, and some kind of non-volatile storage. And in this case, they had the SSH authorized key file in a SquashFS partition. So SquashFS is a read-only file system type used in embedded systems. And so it meant I couldn't easily append my key to the end of that file. And I was really trying to be careful not to break the system. So I didn't play with that at all. But at this point, I'd kind of achieved most of what I set out to do. I'd investigate how the head unit worked. I'd poked around a bit. And I'd ran some of my own software on there in the SSH server. So more interestingly at this point was what had happened to me, how this software update had unexpectedly appeared. And so someone at Mazda had asked for this work to be done. There was a ticket, a job number, next to all the new lines and all the configuration files. You know, adding the new SSH port was CI 2955, and adding the authorized keys file was CI 2954. I'm sure there's a bug tracker somewhere in the world that describes what that task was, indicating it was a careful change control process that had happened there. And so they'd been responsible enough to fix a few of the glaring holes in the system and then send it out to their customers. But could have this been done better? Could it be done over the air, given that we had network connectivity? One car manufacturer, Tesla, they do that. And as do Google with their Chromebook laptops, where they force update out to the consumer systems, giving you the latest bug fixes and security fixes and security updates and whatnot. The downside of this, as I saw, is that they can disable features. So one person's bug is another hacker's feature. And I lost my train of thought. So in the case, my SSH port hacked there. So making user-modifiable systems that also respect the user's freedoms but are secure to malicious intruders is a challenge that we haven't really solved in embedded systems and in consumer software to this point. And that's something that we want to address in the future, I think. We've kind of seen it in mobile phones, in that Android devices can be unlocked. So when you unlock the bootloader in the Android device, you can install your own custom firmware, which is a win for user freedom. After all, you've paid for it. We paid for the hardware. But the downside of that is it disables the cryptographic check that the bootloader is going to be doing on the rest of the system. And so it means that you've broken the boot chain of trust. Anyone could come along and put some malicious software in between at some stage in the boot process without you knowing. And so without the ability to add your own keys to that root of trust in the device, we have to choose between modifying a device and having a secure device. And that's not a compromise I really want to make. And so this is another thing that us as free software and as developers could work on in the future. So I could end the talk there, but there's one more thing that I've forgotten. The title of the talk, Sys Class GPO Parking Brake. So first up, what's a GPO? It's an acronym standing for General Purpose Input Output. And these GPIOs are wires connected to the internals of the CPU, and they can be set on or off by software, allowing software to, say, control the light. There can also be inputs, allowing the CPU to know if something's being turned off or on, or a switch has been activated or whatnot. And Sys is a virtual file system that's exposed by the kernel and Linux systems, and it lets our user space processes interact with the kernel. So back to the story. I was doing a bit more poking around, and the engineers working on this project had used some common Linux APIs to talk to the hardware. One of them is the GPIO lib framework. And this allows the GPIOs to be exposed in Sys class GPIO, which lets user space control them, as I just explained. Normally, the SysFS files have some complicated cryptic number numeral designation that kind of relates to how the driver's been implemented. But it appears that the machine must have had some out-of-tree hacks that gave them labeled GPIOs with meaningful names, which is actually a really good feature that I might look into upstreaming in the kernel. So here we've got the list of GPIOs. You can see some kind of interesting ones in there. But as you saw in the title of the talk, parking brake. So you can imagine my surprise when I noticed that there's a GPIO in my car called parking brake, and this thing's exposed over Wi-Fi. Some detail that you need to know about the car: it can change a electric controlled parking brake. So you press a switch in the middle of the car and it electronically engages or disengages the emergency brake. So this thing is potentially completely software controlled. So maybe someone could disengage it or engage it while I'm going at speed and you know, make bad things happen. So while I was writing this talk, I was having a chat to a friend who happened to hack on Android Auto back in a past life. And he pointed out that this is probably something to do with the car safety legislation standards that we have. And they dictate things like any user action with the car has to contain fewer than N steps, or specific functions have to be disabled unless the parking brakes engage. So as it turns out, much less excitingly, the parking brake GPIO is read-only and it can't be used to kill me. Yeah. Who said, oh, Chris. So that's kind of it. There you have it. We've hacked my car, for some definition of that word. I've shared my findings of the insides. We've spoken a bit about the issues around consumer electronics that need to be addressed in devices that make up the Internet of Broken Things. And I think issues like this are going to become increasingly important for hackers, for companies, for governments, and the Internet as a whole. And I think if we're going to solve the problem of continued device security updates and system security in the near future, that free and open source software is going to have a big part to play. So I've finished quite early because I deliberately wanted to have some time for questions. If we don't have any questions, we can go back to a couple of slides, but I'll open up to the floor to start with.
I need to apologize. I believe I made a source code request to Mazda for the source code for my car, which is why you no longer have a shell. So you got a little bit further than I did, so thank you. I'm going to steal everything. Did you make any equivalent requests? Because mine is apparently still in process.
Did you blog about it?
No, but I have someone tame in Mazda New Zealand chasing it, and Bradley's offered to help at the moment as well.
So. Yeah, so I haven't pursued it at all. There is a blog post by an Australian who contacted their dealer, who got sent to Mazda Australia, who got sent to Mazda Japan, who told him to go away. So there's been a few of us. If you look on Twitter for the name of the automotive company that created the software and GPL, there's two tweets, people asking for it and not getting a response.
So when did your firmware get patched?
Maybe November last year or earlier.
Right, okay, I'm not taking my car into a service at the moment because mine isn't patched still.
Mine's getting serviced right now, so maybe I've got some more hacking to do when I get home. Like literally, my partner just took it into the dealer, so thanks for the question.
Did you get a full NAND dump?
Not a NAND dump, I rsynced the file system over. I'll go to one of my backup slides. So this is the insides. This isn't my picture. I haven't pulled apart my car yet. but people have identified, you know, what's inside there. I assume with a bit more looking, you can find some JTAG or at least clamp on to the SPI. So it uses two flashes. There's the half a gig EMC flash, where most of the HTML and whatever is stored. And then there's an 8 meg SPI flash where the kernel and bootloader is. And that's how they do their fail-safe updating. They have a primary boot path and a fail-safe boot path. So no is the answer, unfortunately.
Does your car, to your knowledge, speak HTTP? Because there was a video by an Australian maybe about a year ago of he had a car that you could speak HTTP to the manufacturer and it would just tell you things about the car.
No, so as I kind of alluded to, I didn't look at any of the packets coming out of the car when I jumped on the Wi-Fi, which is something to add to my to-do list. As far as I know, it's not reporting out, you know, in the research I've done, but I've not verified that for myself.
Have you tried any other notional hacks against the environment? Look what else is read-write or that you can interact with?
Everything inside of it is writable. It's just how much of a risk I want to take. I work remotely. Most of my colleagues are in Canberra. And quite often I brick the machines, and so I have to ask my colleagues in Canberra to fix them for me. I can't do that for my car though, so yeah, I don't want to break it.
So if you put a DVD in and you have a shell, you can actually just play video straight up on the console. It will actually work. The DVD support's enabled in Japan.
Oh, okay.
But it's disabled for countries where you can't have a video display playing live. And because it's using like GStreamer and everything, pretty much any type of file you put on your MP on a USB will just play without video. So if you've got like a concert you want to listen to, just plug in the original video file and you'll be able to listen to the audio without actually having the video come up on the screen.
Oh, cool.
The hack I want to do is turn on the reversing camera while I'm driving. So that was originally going to be my talk for this year, and I didn't have enough time. So thank you for your notes.
Yeah. So one of the majority of the talk on the net in various places is people who are trying to get the Android Auto mirroring app working. So you can plug in your Android phone, and it will mirror the screen with a simple UI for doing Google Maps and whatever on your car. And that was my original motivation for playing with it. I didn't want to pay the $550 Australian for the navigation package. I wanted to use Google Maps on my phone. So,
hey, Joel, great talk. Thank you. Mentioned you plugged in a USB Ethernet adapter. Have you thought of the possibilities if you plugged in a USB 4G dongle?
Yeah, that'd be fun. Usually they require... Yeah, good idea. Do you want to come to Adelaide and we can play?
Out of interest, have you Rich just mentioned about how all the multimedia stuff is based on GStreamer. I recall that there was some obscure file formats for playing audio files for the NES that had some security vulnerabilities in it. Have you tried attacking GStreamer at all?
Yeah, well, so this was my plan. I've got friends who are into reverse engineering, and I wanted to teach myself some of the concepts, but I had root straight away, so there was no work to do. I suspect they haven't enabled all the GStreamer formats just because there's tutorials online about how to enable FLAC support, for instance. But yeah, I mean, if I get home and with the latest update I can't get in, then it's time to start trying to break in.
I also bought a car last year, and there are aftermarket firmwares for my head unit where people have hacked in stuff like being able to watch DVDs while driving, which is, I believe, illegal. Do you have any thoughts on responsibilities of users around things like this as well?
Yeah, it's a bit of a slippery slope. Obviously, what you do to your own car is kind of up to you. But yeah, there's obviously reasons why some of these things aren't in the stock units, and it'd be nice to have a few more features without being overtly illegal. It's a tough one, and particularly when you know some of the forums where this work's going on, it's pretty sketchy. So I'm not sure how often people have your best interests at heart. Yeah, good question. Someone just suggested you can blue tack a laptop to your dashboard. So yeah, that works.
I see there that you've got the CAN interface microcontroller. Does that let you hop the fence and go into the ECU for a bit of performance tuning?
Yeah, someone has done some investigation there. The answer is no. That's why they have this micro there. Apparently, it's a hardware firewall. But that sounds horribly like marketing material to me. So I suspect you can get through there. I haven't looked into it. Someone has pulled the ECU out and done some playing around with that. Which interests me a lot, but not while I still want to drive the car.
Other questions?
There's one down here.
Do you think it'd be possible to buy one of these boards as a spare part to hack on independently, or are they quite carefully controlled by the dealers?
Probably a spare part would be super expensive. I have thought about going to the crash repairers and trying to find a smashed up Mazda 3, because it's the same hardware in a Mazda 3, and getting my hands on one. One of the people that's done one of the better kind of blogs on documenting it, they've got one sitting on their desk next to their laptop, and yeah. So that would be a great way to play without breaking. One of the things I was going to talk about was just future work and what I'd do. And one of the most important ones would be make it easier to experiment without touching the root file system. you know, in theory, you should be able to modify the bootloader so that you could, you know, tell U-boot to boot from an SD card or a USB key instead of from internally, and that way you could play without bricking.
So with the Opera Web UI, there's a one file flag that actually puts it in like a read-only mode, so you can go and like completely rewrite all of the JavaScript and hack on it and enable disable features just by setting one flag from the looks of things through the code. So there's a starting point for playing with it. But have you managed to actually get any of the UI running on a laptop environment, on a non-car environment?
Yeah, getting the basic JavaScript HTML going is fine, but most of what it actually does is launch, load a shared object and launch a process in the background that then takes over the screen until the app exits. So it's not all that interesting to me, at least. At the back.
Following on from sticking in a 4G dongle, could you potentially find your car if you lose it? And
sorry, what was that? I couldn't quite catch it.
Could you find your car if you lost it, if you gave it mobile internet and used the GPS to locate where your car was? And I guess there's when cars have mobile internet by default, then there's the potential, of course, for a manufacturer to look up where a particular car is if they wanted to.
Yeah. That would be cool. You could homebrew that in. That'd be fun. It's a good suggestion.
That sounds like the dude, where's my car feature.
Yeah.
Hi, Joel.
Hey.
Up there, you've got a future potential work to look at the engine data. What engine data is exposed to this device, and did you explore it at all?
I'm not sure how much. No, I haven't explored it. I would hazard a guess that it's similar to what you can get from the OBD slot in the car. Just because that tends to be pretty innocuous. You know, you can't rewrite the ECU from there, but you can get other parameters out. One of the features that the Mazdas have is automatic idle at traffic lights. And as you spend more time idling, little trees grow on the UI. It's just the silliest thing I've ever seen, but yeah. Got to get more idle time so I can grow the tree. Gamify saving, saving the environment. It's good. I don't know. It would be cool to do some more logging. You know, you've got a GPS unit always turned on there, and you've got this engine data, so you could do some kind of correlation between, you know, when I'm driving this route, the engine's behaving like this, maybe I should learn to drive, things like this. Where are we? Sorry, I can't see. This one here.
You mentioned, like, when you got the update, of course, they locked you out, but did you notice that whether that actually made any feature improvements or bug fixes in the UI? Like, speaking for myself, my car is excellent, except for the absolutely horrid implementation of its entertainment unit, and the dealers assured me that there will never be any updates to fix any of the problems I told them about.
Right. Yeah, no, nothing I noticed. I don't drive the car very often. I'm a cyclist. The couple of times I've been in the car, from what I've noticed, it hasn't been any different to what it was before, but yeah.
My immediate question was, did you try plugging a USB keyboard into it when you had the terminal up?
No, but that's a really good idea. I suspect it works, and that's why it's in there. My garage is quite narrow because of all the bikes in there. Also, the car is squashed in there because of the bikes, and so getting in and out is difficult, and yeah. Bluetooth keyboard, yeah. If I could hack, so when you can turn it off in such a way that the entertainment unit will stay on for half an hour, so I can sit in the lounge room for half an hour and hack on it until I have to go back and turn it back on.
So aside from patches and fixes, also around regressions to watch for. So apparently, one of the latter firmware fixes changed the entertainment system. There was a whole load of regressions coming in because they patched a Python library, and suddenly all your audio's in the wrong order on your playlists and everything. So that's another thing to watch for, is the lack of control We have no way of reporting bugs against this head unit. We have no way of raising those issues. And the fix is really, really simple. In fact, there is a, on one of the online forums, there's a way to hack your firmware to apply the fix so that your media now plays correctly. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, no, I agree completely. I guess the NAND backups are how to solve that. You know, if you have a full firmware backup and the manufacturer, obviously the dealer goes and stuffs it up for you, you can revert back. But yeah, it's, I mean, this is why we're at a free software conference. This is why we love free software, I think, so you can fix these issues yourselves. Hey, Thomas.
Especially given the car is only half yours, what's your contingency in case you brick it?
That's why I was really, really careful. When that terminal came up and wouldn't go away, I was panicking.
Actually, just to that, I was wondering that same question, and it would occur to me probably your best strategy is to play dumb. I don't know.
Is to what, sorry? Late. To play dumb. Yeah, yeah. I wasn't... Well,
it's
if
too
I did,
late now.
If I did... But. Yeah, well... Yeah, my partner knows, but my dealer doesn't know I'm giving this talk. And so I did think about that. If I bricked it so hard it didn't turn on, I'm sure I could take it back and just go, oh, these computer things, they're horrible, aren't they? Cool. How are we going for time? Shall we call it? Thanks for coming, everyone. That was really fun.
Thank you, Joel, for...